Last week, I said that The Simpsons was still funny, a phrase which, on the internet anyway, is right up there with saying, you know, that Stalin wasn't that bad of a fellow, or Minecraft is overrated, or offering up for discussion whether Friendship is Magic or Adventure Time is the better show. Anyway, though I stand by my overall premise that the widespread disillusionment with this particular series has more to do with a change in the audience's habits and expectations than it does with some consistent drop in overall quality, I do agree that The Simpsons isn't quite what it used to be. Notice that I've chosen my words carefully, i.e. I did not say that it wasn't as good as it used to be, just that it's not precisely the same creature. After all, what is The Simpsons? This is actually harder to answer than it seems, because the show has existed and been a major pop culture force for so long that it's more of an institution unto itself. But originally, in the before time, in the long, long ago, it had a pretty specific identity. The Simpsons was an absurdist parody. My contention, then, is that the reason it's different now is less because the show itself has changed, but that the world around it has changed, to the extent that almost everything it first existed to skewer, satirize, and parody doesn't exist anymore. When The Simpsons first appeared as short subjects on The Tracey Ullman Show in 1987, it was an analog world with no internet, at least not as we understand it today, and without even an appreciably large amount of cable television. American popular culture was still driven overwhelmingly by the same basic forces that had driven it since the 1950s. Three major television networks, a smattering of local affiliates, and the newspaper magazine industry. While niche entertainment and subcultures existed, there simply wasn't any way for them to be as large or self-sustaining as they can be today in the digital age. Everyone may not have watched or even liked the same programs or followed the same news, but by and large everyone was aware of the same programs and news, because there just wasn't that much else for everyone to be aware of. So when The Simpsons showed up embodying exaggerated characters of the formula sitcom family, colorful dad, saintly mom, one troublemaking kid, one smart kid, the baby, guest starring relatives, wacky neighbors, evil bosses, everyone got it. Immediately. The show's humor was universal, not because it was mocking scenarios that resembled everyone's real life, but because it was mocking the version of real life that everyone had been force-fed by the programming of the monolithically influential Big Three for the last three decades of TV watching. I mean, I was a 10-year-old boy when I started watching The Simpsons. Could I relate to stories about a dad getting in trouble for dancing with a stripper, or a mother having a nervous breakdown and going to a spa, or that same dad becoming a union boss? Of course not. But I got the parody because I, too, had seen those same damn storylines used over and over on every real family sitcom I'd ever watched. American pop culture during the so-called golden age of The Simpsons was a pop monoculture, and Bart, Homer, Marge, Lisa, and Maggie were its most widely circulated satirists. Make a joke about a TV show or some big news story, and chances are almost everyone would get it. And then something happened at the tail end of the 1990s, a period that dovetails nicely with where a lot of dissatisfied fans claim The Simpsons began to lose its luster. The internet. When what was then called the information superhighway first became accessible to average American homes, the big idea was that it was going to unify the culture like never before. Instead, it did exactly the opposite of that. Previously, being a fan or a follower of a property or movement that wasn't part of the cultural mainstream took a lot of work and was often wholly dependent on folks of a similar disposition living in close proximity. With the advent of the internet, aficionados of any aspect of the cultural outskirts, be it an obscure TV show, a forgotten movie, a fringe political movement, could find each other instantly. Combine this with streaming, Netflix, satellites, and an ever-growing roster of cable channels, and there's basically nothing in the popular culture that can truly be said to be shared by everyone anymore. Everything has become fragmented, everything is niche, and everyone is part of this or that fandom, subculture, or political label. The only time in the last decade that anything close to a majority of American media consumers can be said to have all been focused on the same basic thing was 9/11. Now, I don't think that's a bad thing. The specificity of audiences has allowed niche genres and shows to thrive. Game of Thrones or Dexter or Spartacus definitely would never have survived in a non-fragmented television landscape, for example. But the transformation also leaves a show like The Simpsons, which was designed to broadly skewer a mass audience's collective TV-watching and world-observing experience, without much of a foundation. The characters in their world were everymen, built purposefully broad in order to fit into any scenario. Every dad, every mom, every son, every daughter, every bartender, every mole man. But the popular culture just doesn't produce that many every anythings anymore. So what else can such broad characters do but go from exaggerated caricatures of other things to exaggerated caricatures of their own established personas? And while I don't personally feel that this has made them worse, what it has made them is less vital and certainly less relatable. That said, so long as the show can keep its now legendary main voice cast and still attract good writers, I do think it'll remain one of the better things on TV for however long it wants to stick around. So yeah, that's my theory on the matter. And since you can't end one of these without doing it, my top 5 episodes of all time are Last Exit to Springfield, Treehouse of Horror 1, Cape Fear, 24 minutes, and 22 short films about Springfield. I'm Bob, and that's The Big Picture.